12. It's Miss Pavone. So today's PowerPoint and video clips will be covering the importance of physical evidence. Physical evidence is any and all types of objects or imprints or fragments or bodily elements that can establish a crime that has been committed, provide a link between the crime and its victim, or provide a link between a victim and the perpetrator. So why should it be collected? Well, because it aids in the solution of a case, it provides an element, or can provide an element of the crime, and it could potentially prove a theory in that case. And for both, for either the defense or the prosecution, it could easily prove or disprove any statements made in their arguments or made in the trial. So it is very important that evidence is thoroughly analyzed and properly utilized by either side of the trial. So examples of physical evidence include paint chips, glass, footprints, tire tracks, fingerprints, ballistics. So when I say ballistics, I mean bullets or bullet shells, like the casings, dust, dirt, DNA, so that's hair, fingernails, skin, bone, teeth, blood, and other bodily fluids that could potentially show up at a crime scene or on a victim. Now I'm gonna switch over and I will take you through fingerprints and footprints. Okay, hello Law 12, good morning, good evening, good afternoon, because I really don't know when you do your homework or look at our emails or start the assignment, so cover all my bases. So I wanted to talk about, obviously today, the importance of evidence in criminal cases, and just getting more into depth in the importance of certain types of evidence. So the first slide, obviously, we're starting off with fingerprinting. So think about how much you touch Lysol. No, just how much you touch things every day. A coffee cup, a car door, computers, your phone. Each time you do that, you leave behind your unique signature, your individualized print. No two people have the exact same fingerprints, even identical twins with identical DNA. They have different fingerprints, different patterns, different loops, swirls, notches, scars. Everything's individualized to you. So this uniqueness allows fingerprints to be used in all sorts of ways, of identifying people, including background checks, biometric security. So like your phone, oh yeah, my phone's there. It's recording. I was going to do the fingerprint thing on the iPhone. Never mind. Scanning in, biometric security, mass disaster identification, which is, if you think about it, so awful. But the fact that we have this sort of advancement in forensic science, that if there was some sort of, I don't want to say pandemic, like not coronavirus, I'm saying like a tsunami, and there's all these unidentified lost loved ones. Teeth, fingerprints, you can identify them. And of course, obviously, fingerprinting is used in criminal situations. So like I mentioned in this slide, this analysis, or this type of analysis, has been used to identify suspects and solve crimes for more than 100 years. And obviously, the technology to do so has gone much better, to the point where it's not just fingerprints, it's not just about dusting, it's about, it can be used with aerosols. They can read fingerprints through gloves. So if you're thinking, hey, why don't I just wear gloves if I'm going to commit a crime? Nah. They can look it up through the glove now. They're that smart. So I'm going to I fingerprinted myself. Can you see that? It's awful lighting. Don't look. Okay, but look. Okay, so I fingerprinted myself. I'll attach on the next slide a different, if you're able to get your fingerprint and try to match it, I'm going to put a fingerprint identifier so you can look at if you're an a plain arch or an ulnar loop or a radial loop. It's really interesting actually to look at how unique your finger, your essentially your fingerprint is and what unique identity it holds just for you. Last time I was able to make a collage with my students' fingerprints, but fortunately we can't do that this time. But anyway, I think it'd still be really neat for you to see your fingerprint. And if you want to attempt to dust your fingerprint, I would get your parent or guardian's permission, but some sort of lotion on your finger, thumb, on a mirror or a glass, like a window, and baby powder. And just kind of lightly like sprinkle it on and blow it off. It should actually give you a fingerprint, like you're a crime scene investigator. That's enough for this slide. Thank you. I'll see you in a minute. I'm back. Okay, so now we're moving on to footprints. Now, the likelihood forensic investigators come across a bare footprint at a crime scene, sorry. Not very likely. So what we're looking at is usually impressions of the footwear, the patterns of the footwear. And these are the most, actually these are the most commonly found types of evidence in crime scenes, but because they're usually such poor quality and there's such a wide variability, like sample, my shoe, it's a Vans, okay? The treads are pretty standard, not too worn out, but now if I was being charged based on a shoe print, that wouldn't hold up. I mean, you could think about how many people own size 6 female Vans with this exact same tread marks. I want to say more than just me. I don't know if they're not hip anymore. I don't know. But anyway, what I'm saying is they're just so variable, and these patterns are so widely manufactured that you're not going to identify a person based on the shoe necessarily, but you can identify the shoe print and match it to other shoe prints found at other crime scenes. So if you say have a repeat offender, you could say that these shoe prints at this homicide match the shoe prints found at this other homicide a week later. So you could figure out whether the same murderer, killer, whatever, criminal, was at multiple crime scenes. So shoe prints or footprints are good in that sense. So to preserve these prints, usually forensic scientists will take a cast of the footprint and preserve it. So they'll usually have, it's kind of like they'll pour it in like a cement mold almost and cast the shoe print and take the casting. I mean, technology has advanced and now they could probably take that casting and scan it and keep it in their computer systems that way, so they won't have to physically keep the casting for long, but that's how they would collect the evidence. And some interesting things that can be told from shoe prints are, like, for example, if I stamped my shoe print, both my feet, it would probably show that I put more weight on my right leg than my left, and that would be from a knee injury. And so you could potentially figure out some things from partial shoe prints, because if there's like a full mark with this foot and maybe a half, I don't know, like a half tread with this foot based on different why can't I speak? Being, Miss Pavone doesn't make videos often of talking to herself in her room. So, let's start over. Okay. I'm back. I'm calm. I'm collected. I've figured out that I enjoy talking to myself. I should be a TikTok star. Now, anyway, okay, what I was saying before is, so you could find out some interesting facts about the people who leave these footprints, like someone with a weak knee, based on how weight-bearing the print is. But like, other than like their, maybe their, you can also tell like their height, based on their shoe size, like potentially you could kind of get a rough estimate, but really shoe prints aren't how you identify a criminal. You can place them there. You can place them at the scene of the crime. So if there's some sort of, if you are being brought to court because they think you set off some sort of like chemical bomb or blew up this place, they could take your shoe and take samples from the treads and try to match it to, one, match the treads to a print at the crime scene, and two, they could match evidence from the crime scene that was left on your shoe, so say chemical evidence. So like I said before, shoe prints aren't used to identify a perp, a criminal, but they can be helpful in kind of narrowing down their identity. So if your shoe prints like men's size 12, you're not going to be looking at 4'9" petite women feet. I mean, the likelihood that someone who leaves a shoe print this size has a foot that is actually this size, unlikely, but kind of smart if you think about it from the criminal side. But I'm not trying to give you any hints on how to evade police and walk around with shoes that are like 12 sizes too big for you. Don't do that. But yeah, so that's enough for shoe printing. Shoe printing. That's enough for foot printing. Printing. Well, Law 12, it's been a long day, and it's the moment you've all been waiting for. It's time for you to go through the PowerPoint and follow along in your textbook. So, thank you for watching the video. I want you to go through the PowerPoint, go through the terms of the textbook, match them up, take some notes, and if you have any questions, of course, email me, flag me down in class, anything you need. I'm here to help. Have a lovely day.